MongoDB. Last time we talked about JSON, and I think it fits very well that today we'll talk about MongoDB. So first of all, not only SQL databases or not relational databases, it's a very popular area these days. And the idea is that there are no tables and no table normalization, which we'll learn about next week. It allows non-structured data. Basically, the data may be structured as needed, which is what we discussed last class about JSON. You can basically have, it's schemaless. You can have just the document, and the document may contain records with different structure, different data fields. The underlying storage format for most of these NoSQL databases usually is JSON, but not only. You may have graph databases like Neo4j, which are triple stores, which are actually following just a triple database format. You have basically predicate, subject, and object. So you have basically three values, the node, the two vertices, and the label on the edge that connects to those two vertices. But usually it's JSON. The current NoSQL databases are led by JSON databases, in particular MongoDB. It handles big data, so we'll talk about a bit why they are more popular for some applications. The fact that you have horizontal distribution of data, if you have a lot of data, but very simple data that you don't use in joins, you can basically just distribute it to multiple servers, small servers. You don't have to have a very big server that stores all the data and does the querying. So as I said, you have no predefined schema. The data can be unstructured, is cheaper, easier to manage. And we will talk about the differences between scaling horizontal and scaling out. And scaling horizontal basically fits the relational databases, and scaling out fits the NoSQL databases. So scaling out versus scaling up are two different ideas. And basically, relational databases are designed to be hosted on a single server. It's possible to split a relational database to multiple servers, but there are many adjustments that need to be made. Basically, for joins, for relationships, you have to try to put elements, put relations that are strongly connected on the same server. It's very hard to split one single table that is huge to multiple servers, because now you basically will have different servers running the same database. And when you run a query, for instance, a transitive closure, you would have to join the same table from different databases, from different servers. So this scaling up really means acquiring a higher capacity or a high performance server. So if you need more users or more data, the only solution is really you buy a more expensive server with bigger hard drive or with more processors. NoSQL databases, on the other hand, can be distributed with replicated copies or slices of the data. In other databases are called shards, on multiple servers, because really the idea is that you don't have complicated joins. So you only query one table or one equivalent of a table, one big document, for different parts of that document. So when you need to scale the operation, like you have more users and more data or more data, you can scale out. Simply you add more little servers. So there are advantages of both. Sometimes you need more joins, and then you need relational databases. And sometimes you just have more data, but very simple data. So there are advantages of relational databases. They are good for relational data when you have the structure of the data that all your data follows. The data items have a set content. You know what are the schema, what are the tables, relations, what are the columns or attributes in these relations. You know how the data is related, what field is a foreign key to what other relation primary key. You may have done normalization, which we'll talk about next week. It eliminates redundancy in a database. Basically, you don't have redundancy, the same data represented in different tables. It minimizes the space usage, and that require that basically takes you to better performance in time and in space. There is one single standard query language, which it's kind of standard. I mean, it's standard, but not everybody implements the standard. But however, you learn one query language, and that fits all of these relational databases, be they Oracle, be they IBM DB2 or any other. You can define integrity checks through integrity constraints, and that's both check constraints, assertions, if you have assertions, primary foreign keys, and so on. And more importantly, it supports transactions. If you have data that changes, the best type of databases that you can use are relational, because you can implement transactions. Like you withdraw some money from one account, deposit it in another account. Maybe you have a complicated set of steps that takes the money through different accounts or through different temporary accounts to do the transaction. So you need to have these ACID properties, then relational databases are again for you. You can do that with NoSQL, but you have to implement it yourself. You have to implement rollback. What does rollback means? It means that if you try to execute multiple steps and somewhere you fail, you have to implement what happens, that these updates that you have done in the database have to be undo. You have to basically have to put the money back from the account from which you withdraw the money. There are multiple types of NoSQL databases. The ones that are considered totally schemaless are the ones that are based on JSON or XML, like MongoDB, CouchDB. There are also key value stores, which really what they are just associative arrays that are distributed on a network or over the internet. Either that they are too big, or they are stored and updated from different locations. And that's what Redis and Memcache are doing. Cache systems like Couchbase server, they are again good for huge databases, but with very simple data, just associative arrays, key value pairs. They are very fast, and they mirror each other quite easily because they are very simple. Not very customizable, because the only thing they implement are associative arrays. Then there are column databases like Apache Cassandra that are optimized for reading the entire column instead of actually doing selection on rows. They are good for analytics, data science, and lots of applications for machine learning. They reduce the number of disk input outputs because you are only loading the attributes that you are needing, not the entire tuple in the database on which those attributes are the ones that you select. Then there are graph databases. We'll not get into those this class, but this is a large field. The leader in this area is called Neo4j. There are others like Stardog, which basically they represent the entire graph, the entire database as a graph, key value, basically, subject, object, predicate. So you have only triples, the two nodes, and the edge between them. They are popular for knowledge graphs, like Wikidata and DBpedia are basically using their graphs. They internally, they are representing everything as a graph. There are standard languages like Sparkle, that is basically a language like SQL, but it's for querying a graph knowledge base. Everything is basically a node, and these nodes are connected through edges. Again, there are the one problem about NoSQL databases is there is nothing standardized. So each one of them has its own query language and its own way to own type of applications on which they are the best. So what are the drawbacks of NoSQL databases? Data is duplicated on multiple servers, depending on which one you hit. The most importantly, they don't support ACID because of consistency. You do an update on one server, it's not replicated on the other one. So they don't support transactions at all, these systems. They are not read optimized. And NoSQL has to read all the data in all blobs for a simple query. You run a query to, let's say, select one employee, you have to read the entire document to find that employee. So they don't have separate indices for that specific extracting one employee or one employee with a certain salary. Joins are manual, and I will show them at the end. This is a MongoDB program that computes joins. It's extremely inefficient. Basically, if your data has orders and products, basically how you do a join, a simple join in which you want a simple join. You basically want the status of the product that is chocolate heaven. And for this, you basically iterate over all the collection or all of the orders. And then for every order, you have to look up for those in products where the product ID is the same with the ID in orders. And this is basically quite unreasonable for at least a relational database. If you consider our project for this class, in which you basically have to find from the well was the result for a test for an employee, you would have to write such a query that basically iterates through all of the middle, the relation tables from pool mapping to well mapping and so on. It's quite unreasonable to write such aggregates. So basically they are not easy to use for joins, but they work quite well for selecting data over a single document. In particular, we are going to talk today about MongoDB. So Mongo is a document-based NoSQL database. It stores everything as JSON internally. It supports a shell interface as well as a GUI. So if you actually installed MongoDB, and you should install it both on your own computer and so you know how to basically use it on your own computer, or you can install a cloud version of it. And directly on the website of Mongo, I can show it to you now. Basically, you have the option to create a cloud database using Mongo. Or you can basically download the software and install it yourself. I downloaded the community server. And then I also downloaded the MongoDB Compass. So Compass is basically the client similar to MySQL Workbench, which you basically install. And it looks like this. It's basically a simple way to see the database, create new databases. In this version, I'm using the local database. But I have multiple, I have basically the local one and the cloud one. And I'm going to use the local one because of latency issues. So you can create a new database. One thing to be careful about Mongo is that, a database must contain at least one record before you can actually use it, before it's actually created. Even just stating that you create the database will actually create that database. Using it will create that database for you. So show databases basically shows you the current databases that are available. If you want, you can use a database. Like for instance, let's use admin. And in admin, we can show the collections, which are the equivalent of tables in these databases. I misspelled. Show the collections. I only have system version in that collection. Okay. So you can basically install these two, the server and then the GUI, and you basically can start using the MongoDB commands. And so there are many basic commands to in MongoDB. Show DBs shows the database is known by the current Mongo server. UseDB selects a database which will work to work with. If a database doesn't exist, it will actually create that database. DB returns the name of the database currently in use. Like in our case, it will return admin. DB new collection dot insert, and then the record that you want to insert creates a new collection and starts inserting into that collection. And also it starts inserting if you have the collection, and drop deletes the collection named with that collection name. So the first command that we will learn is insert, or insert one. It inserts one record into the collection. So basically insert many will insert multiple records in the collection. So the first example, let's say that we do a use music, which creates a new database music. And then in that we create a collection albums, and then we insert an album, like for instance, this album by the Bangles. And you can see it's basically pure JSON, and it will create and that collection and insert into that collection an element. So it basically inserts one document into the albums collection, in the music database. So that we have the music database, the albums collection, and in that one document, basically we include multiple attributes, title, artist, genre, and so on. So we'll basically do exactly this in MongoDB. So in MongoDB, you can basically either use to create the database, the buttons that you have available. I personally use the MongoDB shell. And you can basically also run this shell from your CMD, your command prompt, which we'll actually do when we do more node examples. So we use music, and now we basically we insert in the collection albums, that specific album that we wanted to insert. So the response from MongoDB is that at this time we inserted the album, and it's basically, it acknowledges that it's there. So we actually created a new database music. Within the database music, we created a new collection albums. And you can see basically we inserted a new object in that database, okay? And you can basically insert an object multiple times, because really what you're doing, you're creating a new ID. So the ID is automatically created. So it's basically different. It's kind of like a primary key. But one thing is that you can specify the ID yourself. So you can basically specify what is the ID of the object that you want to insert as part of this underscore ID would be the attribute. Now, finding data in a MongoDB database is done with find. So it's like streaming that we have in Java and JavaScript. So on a database that was already created in a collection, find will find all the documents in the collection and print them. If the first attribute is, you can pass in the attribute on which you project on, or a value to match. So basically what it does, it finds all the attributes that matches that attribute value pair that is given. Find one finds only the first element, the first document that matches the criteria. So find is like find all, finds all of them, and find one finds one of them. So for instance, in our database that we basically created, DB music albums find pretty will basically return all the documents in the collection. Pretty is used to prettify. So it's basically, you get a JSON, but it's not quite nice. So if you want to prettify, so it's humanly readable, you would use this pretty. It's basically one of the aggregates that we will see later. You can do sort, you can do pretty, which is basically reformats the output to be an isable form. So like in our example, I can show you directly that we have this Mongo server running and we can run db.albums.find. And it returns basically the albums that I inserted before. And with pretty, it basically prettifies a little bit more those albums. It's almost the same, barely visible, that is prettier than before. Okay. So it's really a way. So one thing to notice is that if you are already in that database that you are looking at, you can ignore the database. You can directly say db.albums.find. And this applies to all of the next slides that I have here. Always, basically, you don't need to specify the database if you are already using it. Okay. So I will just replace it now so I don't have to do it later. Let's see what question do we have in the chat. When did we create albums? You actually created them the moment that you insert the first document in one. So the moment that you insert a record in a collection, that collection is created. And in fact, if we remove that collection or we remove the every single element in that collection, even the database disappears. So let me show you such an example. If we say db.albums.drop. So basically albums is just a collection within the music database. So now I basically dropped albums. It will actually drop the entire database music. So a database can only exist if there is at least one document in it. So that's something to be very careful about, because you can basically drop the entire database if you drop the last collection, the last document in it. So really it's schemaless. The moment that there is no element, the schema disappears. Okay. So let's continue. So we saw the finding the data. If you want to basically filter on some documents, so db.albums.findPublication 1988 returns all the documents with the publication attribute of 1988. So basically, if I have that database of music that contains multiple songs, it will collect those that the publication is in 1998. So Carly Simon and Acoustic Alchemy and so on. So it's a way to filter out. I want those documents, those JSON objects for which the attribute publication is 1998. Okay. Now, if I want only the one of them, then I can use find one. So find one returns one document with the publication of 1998. One thing to notice is that you don't need pretty here. Find one already does that for you in the MongoDB, both the shell and compass shell. Okay, next one is find reloop relative operation attribute and value. So basically this finds documents values where you specify the relative operation, like greater than equal, less than equal. So here I have an example. Basically, I want those albums where the runtime is less than 39 minutes. So basically, you have to specify first that you're looking at the runtime attribute. And then for that attribute, we have the condition as a separate JSON, which specifies that it's also a key value pair that specifies that it has to be less than 39 minutes. So it will actually collect all of those for which the running time is less than 39 minutes. So this one has 35, this one has 29, and so on, many other tuples. Or greater than, all the albums whose publication is greater than 1988, so after 1988. And in this case, it returns only one in my database, which is basically from 1989. Text searches. So another feature of NoSQL databases, which is also now replicated in relational databases with like, is that you can create a text index on a certain field name, like the titles, and then you can basically use text commands, text search commands. You specify the text, the search, and the string that basically what you're looking for in that text. And here I have an example. You want, first I create an index on the artists, and I specify that create an index, a text index on artists, and it succeeded by stating that yes, it created a new, the previous index was on the entire tuple, the entire document, and now we are looking for indices, a second index that was inserted, which is a text index for artists. And now we can basically specify that I want to find with a text search for Bangle, for basically the artist to be Bangles, or any field to contain Bangles. So it searches any document where the artist attribute includes Bangles. So we can see that it basically returns that document in which the artist is Bangles. And I actually didn't specify anyway that it's the artist attribute has to be Bangles. This is looking for any text in any field that contains Bangles. Okay. Now you see the command is quite intricated. You have to specify that you are looking for a text search, that you are looking for text, then for search, then that you are looking for those that basically contain Bangles, and you have to specify that this is a string which contains it's basically a string that contains a string, and you have to basically escape both of double quotes inside the double quotes that specify the search criteria. So it's a quite complicated syntax, but it lets you to basically search for text search within any field in the database. Then there are those functions that modify the return document set. And the one of them we already saw, pretty, that prints the return data in a prettified form. Sort, sorts the return values on some field, ascending or descending. We can specify with one and minus one if we want the different sorts. Count, which actually returns a number instead of actually JSON, so returns the number of records rather than the data. Limit, which returns only a limited number of results in the document. So this is similar to limit in MySQL. I only want the first 10 tuples. So this is the first example, sorting. So I basically specify that I want from this document, all the document, all this collection, all the documents with the artist, the Alan Parsons project, sorted from the last publication to the oldest publication year. So I basically specified with minus one that I want descending order, and that descending order is on the publication. And then finally, I prettify the entire thing. So it basically starts printing the, returning the documents in reverse order. And this happens to be the last record of that specific artist. Okay. So it's really, after find, you can continue this streaming operations for sorting, prettifying, and other operations. Count is another aggregate. Basically, after find, I want all of the documents whose artist is the Alan Parsons project. And in this case, it will return that is basically two. It doesn't return the data itself, it only returns the count. So it's a function that returns a number. Limit, as I said before, it's instead of returning all of the documents with the artist attribute, that artist that I basically put there, Alan Parsons project, it returns the first one that it finds in the collection. So it's like find all in this case, because I put a limit of one, but you can put a limit of two, of three, of 10, wherever many you want. Now, there is also special processing on the results for each. It performs a function on each of the documents returned by find. So for instance, I find all of the documents whose publication is less than 1988, less than 1988, and then I sort them by publication, ascending the publication year in ascending order. One means ascending, minus one is descending. For each, and I pass a function, what happens? In this case, for each one, I just print out the title, string followed by the document title. Then I basically print the number of tracks and the songs on those, a number of songs on those tracks. So it's really a way to now embed a function in this stream that basically processes every single document that I get in the stream. Sometimes I actually create a new stream, a new JSON object instead of that object, and I basically serialize them into a new set of objects. So in this case, basically what happens, it finds all of the publications before 1988, sorts by the publication year, and prints the title, and then after a number of spaces, the number of tracks on that album. Okay, so it's a streaming operation that continues with the next steps of the stream. Altering data. So we had update operations in SQL. We also have them in MongoDB. Updates values in one or more documents. It may replace the entire document with a new copy. It may replace selected attributes. And there are operators like for replacing selecting attributes, increment attribute with an increment value, set to a new value, rename with the, from the old name to the new attribute, to the new name. And there are many other options which are basically mixing them, upsert and so on. So here is an example update that for basically the it adds a new field with the title stereonomy and it sets to the value true. And basically this will succeed with this line which says that it wrote the result into the database. And now if we find the title stereonomy, we can basically see that for this title stereonomy favorites, a new field is added that is true. So it basically modified that document to add a field favorites true. So the set command adds additional fields to the current document, to the document selected by the update. Then there are increment, which basically what happens is for the document different with title different light, the increment function, it increments the runtime with 2. So the runtime before it was 39 and now it's updated to 41. So again, it succeeds by stating how many it matched, how many it modified. And then if you use find, it shows the ones that it modified because we are using the same command, the same field on which we update. If you don't put a selector, it will update all of the documents with that increment function of 2 or with the set value. You can change a field name in one document to another field name. So for instance, I want to rename runtime to total minutes. So now in my document, instead of having runtime, I have total minutes to 90 minutes. So this is an update that updates one specific document that has the title Greatest Hits Live, composed by Carly Simon, from one attribute runtime to total minutes. And we can basically see it here. Deleting data. So if you want to delete a certain applicable document or a set of applicable documents, you can basically use the function remove. So we want to remove the document with artist Carly Simon, and it basically removes all the documents with the artist of Carly Simon. In my database, I only had one to be removed. So it's kind of like delete from database that we had in SQL. How do you connect to MongoDB? So because we learned Node, the first thing that you need to do is install MongoDB. And then you have access to the MongoDB package, which will allow you to do everything, create new databases, insert, select, or basically find records and so on in the database. And I will go over all of this with you. So the first one is to create a new database. If you didn't have it before, you basically can require the MongoDB client. So you require the MongoDB package. From that package, the MongoDB client. In my case, I will just connect to the URL, which is my own database. I can connect to the one that is on the Atlas server, but just using the basically the link, which actually includes the user credentials. And then I create a new connection to MongoDB, and I basically create that database and I close it. Okay. So, and the only thing that I have to do is to actually connect to the new database. And that basically for that URL, it creates in MongoDB. Actually, the database is not created until you get content, which I actually told you before. And also, MongoDB waits until you have created at least a collection, the equivalent of a table in relational databases, with at least one record before it actually creates that database and collection. So I can show you. Basically, now I create a database. So note, I already installed MongoDB. So there is nothing to install anymore. Now I can run Node. And these are really functions in Node. And I just created the database. I passed the entire code that created the database to Node. Okay. So most importantly, we have to create a collection. So for creating a collection, I do something similar. I basically connect to the MongoDB database. Then I create a new collection. In this case, I call it customers. And I basically close the connection. I don't do anything with it because what I want to do is actually to start inserting into this collection. So you can insert a new tuple into this collection by selecting that collection customers and then starting inserting one. So this is the same basically function insert one or insert. And in this case, I want to insert the my object that I created, the JSON object created above. So this object is just a name for basically a set of key value pairs. The name is the company Inc. and the address is Highway 37. So this is for creating the collection in Node. And the second one is for inserting a document. So really I'm creating the object and then I'm inserting it into my current collection customers. Okay. So the syntax is very close. That's the whole point, that it's very easy to do it in JavaScript because you are creating key value pairs. But that's almost the same when you select a tuple from MySQL using the MySQL driver, you are getting an object in JavaScript. So it's not that much of an increase. Okay. If you want to insert multiple documents, so for instance, you want to insert the entire list of all of these documents, pairs, John, Highway 91, Peter, Low Street 4, and so on. You insert many and then you pass the list of all of those objects. So it's really easy to insert multiple objects into the MongoDB database. In this case, I'm inserting 14 objects. And again, if you already have, you can start. So let's use the database MyDB. And you can show collections here, customers, and for the DB customers, you can find all of the tuples. So you can see that basically everything that we are doing in Node we actually have in Mongo. So it's basically the same. This is the server that automatically you get updated from your code. Okay. So the next thing is the result object contains this ID, and the IDs are basically automatically generated by the MongoDB database. So this ID field, if you don't specify it, then MongoDB will add one for you and assign a unique ID to each document. It's basically the primary key if you think in relational databases. If you do specify the ID, then the value has to be unique for each object, because each document, because it's really the primary key. So if you want to specify the ID, you basically can do it. So in this case, I'm actually creating, inserting multiple objects into a database products, and each one of the objects has its own attached ID. So underscore ID with the value 154, 155, 156. Sometimes you actually are using these IDs, especially when you are doing joins. Joins are complicated, but you can do them. So this is that database that creates a product database. And it basically, the result will be all of these objects that have these IDs. So for products, I can again query my database. Give me all the products. And these are the products available in my database. So you can specify the ID yourself. Find one is similar to find, only that it gives you the only one first occurrence in the selection. The first parameter of find one is a query object. So now we can introduce querying if we want, basically the field on which we want to filter the results. Empty query selects all the documents in the collection. So find one will return like find, but only the first element of the collection. So in customers, we return John, the first object that I had in my collection. So now, most cases, I want to do some kind of filtering. So the second parameter of find is the projection parameter. So I don't filter on anything. The select statement is empty. But then I basically state that I want to project my fields only to return the name and address of all the documents in collections. So one means basically, yes, return that one attribute, and address one means return the address. So if I have other attributes, they will be ignored. Like zero means ID, I do not return the ID, okay? Then I basically pass them to the array that will be returned as my result. So because we already have this database with all of the customers, I can run this query. And you basically see that it only returns the name and address. It doesn't return the ID, but I don't specify the fields to include, only the fields to exclude. And in this case, it's only the address. So that's probably it. When you do want to specify some fields to exclude, but not those that are included by default, you basically only specify the exclude ones. So if I want to exclude the address, I can basically exclude the address and return the ID. Yeah. And if I want to exclude more than just the address, so in this field, in this case, I want to let's also exclude the ID. I basically can do that. So let's see if this works. And yes, in this case, I only get the name. So if you exclude some of the fields, it looks to me that you have to you have to assume that all of the other fields are included. So this is something that I didn't know about MongoDB. Okay, so the if you, in this case, you get a result as an array, and you can put it in a variable. You can basically get from that result only the address field or other fields. So for instance, if you want the third document, the address field, then you basically select that with an indexed variable, and then you select the attribute address. So, okay, when you find elements in a collection, you may want also to filter the results using a query object. So for instance, I want those for which the address is Park Lane 38. So basically the first argument, as I said, in find is the query, and the query is a JavaScript object. So in this case, it basically does exactly the same query that we had before, that but I'm filtering, is like a select statement in SQL. I'm filtering for those where the address is that address there. Okay. So now it basically, we can see that it basically returned the fact that Ben is at Park Lane number 38. Okay, you can also filter with regular expressions like the search field. So if you want all of the documents where the address field starts with the letter S, you use this regular expression, forward slash hat, or hat S forward slash. So it's basically a filter that filters all the documents in customers where that query basically filters on address that starts with S. So again, it's basically the same query that we had before, but with filtering. These are two examples. Richard stays at Sky and Viola at Sideway, both starts with capital S. You can sort the result. So these are all the MongoDB functions that we had before. So once you obtain the result, you can sort, and you can specify on what do you want to sort, what attributes, and in what order. So for instance, in ascending order on the name, you would specify in my sort object name has the value 1. If you want them in descending order, you would use -1. That is in descending order, okay? So let me write you the two examples. So actually, let me take out this comment. Otherwise, the example, because it's not using new lines, they are not copied properly, will basically contain that as a comment. And then the entire line is commented out. So you see they are basically sorted by name in alphabetical order. And again, if you want to limit them to, let's say, 10 elements, you can do that. If you want to sort them in reverse order, you can do that. You just need to specify -1. Deleting elements. So you can insert, but you can also delete using node. So for instance, if I want to delete the first occurrence or the first one where the address is mountain 21, you use the delete function. Everything else stays the same. Delete 1 deletes the first occurrence of the of a document where the address is mountain 21. And again, I will run it. So you see that in fact, there was one that the address was with that value. Deleting all the documents, like for instance, I want all of the customers whose address starts with O. And it's similar to the previous one, only that now it specifies that this is a regular expression for documents that start with O. Updating the documents for valley, for the address valley 345 and the name Mickey, the address is Canyon 123. So basically, the set function that we saw before is the one that sets a new value, new attributes. And in my case, I basically update. So the update one updates those that match the query. In my case, the query is that those that contain the address value 345, and then you specify the new values. And in our case, name is a new attribute, and that replaces the name. And actually, it was before too, but the address is replaces the address that we had before. So now there will be a new document that basically contains this new attribute Mickey. Updating only specific fields, like for instance, I only want to update the address from Valley 345 to Canyon 125. It's exactly the same example, but with basically only the old attribute for querying and the new attribute for setting. It's similar to the previous example, only that I'm not updating the name. Limiting only to a number of elements. So at any point before you transform it to an array, you basically limit the results in this stream. So for instance, in this case, we are limiting to the first five results of the documents that we are getting. So let me show you this query. So these are only five of those 14 or probably 13 that were left in the database. Okay. Joining is the most complicated operation. So I basically told you before that since MongoDB is not a relational database, you cannot perform joins using standard just Cartesian product and then join on a specific condition. But you can perform left outer joins. So left outer joins are basically are iterating over one set of collections. And then for every one of those collections, you can use the lookup function. So the lookup function lets you specify which collection you want to join with and which fields should match from the new collection to the old collection. Now in the result, you will basically get an outer level, which basically has the value in the old collection, and then what's the value that was selected in the new collection. So let's consider that we have orders, and orders have attributes like ID 1, product ID 154, status 1, and so on. And then you have another collection of products, and products has ID 154, name chocolate heaven, ID 155, name testy lemons, and so on. How do we do a join? Quite complicated. We select the collection orders, and then we have a stream attribute, stream function aggregate, which does a lookup. It looks in the products collection where the local field in the collection orders is product ID, and it is a foreign key to the ID in the products, and it basically returns the order details as the new inner value. What is the value that will be mapped from the joint function to the current to the joint document to the current document? So basically, yes, it gets those orders in which only one order in our case, and that was the order for which the product ID was 154. And the order details is that 154 stands for chocolate heaven. So it does a join because we are basically getting that the outer product is basically mapped to one of the inner products. But you can see how complicated is this join. And you can imagine how would you do a join with multiple relations, what we had in our project. It's